Hello and welcome to the latest episode of Weekend Winners in association with BetVictor. And on this week's show, we're going to be looking ahead to the best of the all-weather action at Kempton, as well as taking an early aim at some of the races over the Grand National fences at Aintree next week. Now, alongside me, we've got a little bit of a mix-up. We're in a different location as well, but I'm delighted to say that in place of Declan Ricks this week, because he's on holiday, we have senior form analyst Jamie Lynch alongside the very informed Sam Boswell. So, Jamie, it feels right that we should start in your spiritual homeland of the Skypad.
I think so, Kate, and start with some demand, because obviously you are getting a heavy hitter today, so I've put some demands out for you to try and justify. Can we clear all these, Kate? You read them out for Sam.
Yes, OK, so number one, we've got race previews to be done from the Skypad.
Tick.
Tick. Number two, 15 bitcoins.
Oh, I don't know, this is a big money move. We'll have to see. One week trial, maybe.
Bitcoin's a big thing, Amber, though.
1 week trial, we'll weigh that up post-recording. Number three, the removal of the price 16-5 from BetVictor's odds matrix. Oh, Declan will be on that one.
I mean, yeah, there's a few people that would like that, Jamie, but we'll have to wait and see.
And number four, Sam to do his impression of Declan on air like he does in The Office.
Maybe at the end of the show.
We do have a bingo card. For what it's worth, we have a bingo card for Declan Rixey's isms anyway. So they are the four. Perfect start for you, Jamie, to the show. We're already ticking box number one as well.
Well, ticking box number one, that's because we're here. But we're going to look at three races from Kempton, starting with Kate.
Starting with the 205, yeah. Then, we're going to be kicking off with... Now, this is the Snowdrop Fillies Stakes listed action for four-year-olds and over a mile here. Now, of course, the favourite in here at 4-1 at many tiers has to defy the £3 penalty on her first run for James Ferguson. So, Jamie, as our guest of honour, would you like to kick us off?
I'd love to go first, Kate. And many tiers, you said, the penaliser, and that presents a problem for her, I think, especially with a new regime. Let's go to the horse who I think is really interesting here. And there's lots of devices open to the senior form analyst, but I think the primary one is text Kevin Blake and see what he says about the Joseph O'Brien horse. And he just said it'll win. That's not true at all. But let's have a look at Adelaide's, because I bet that both Kevin and Joseph O'Brien were staggered that Adelaide's has not yet won for them. This was Royal Ascot last year. This is Adelaide's. And just chart her progress or lack of progress through, because in the 18 run of Sandringham, she was really unlucky at every single stage. You can see that she's trying and failing to get any room. And spoiler alert, she gets beaten less than a length into four. So this sort of followed her career in the sense of she's been really unlucky every time she's come to the track. Now, her last two runs were in a listed race in France, probably a stronger listed race than what she faces today. And I just think that the agenda's important here, Kate, because why is she coming to Kempton? First time out in Britain? Well, I think that's because they're thinking that it's a good spot for her. She's won at Kempton and it might be catching a few cold at the same time as well. So Adelaide's, for me, makes all sorts of sense in here.
And a decent price then to go with as well, though. But like I say, that reappearance start then for her. It is an interesting move, Sam, isn't it, for her to be coming over here this first start. But it's kind of that time of year where we're trying to weigh up the recent form over the winter on the all-weather with these horses making their reappearance starts. But where were you looking?
Yeah, it certainly is. And I kind of had a little bit of an angle in terms of I was quite keen to have a horse that's been quite busy recently. A couple of starts over in Maidan, in Mystic Pearl.
Yeah.
We're going to fire up the replay of watching her back in Deauville. That's going back a little bit in time to last summer. But I thought this was a really, really big run. She's on the inner here. She's just going to get chinned. Ryan Moore gave her a great ride this day. This is the kind of ride I'd love to see her get at Kempton as well on Saturday. I don't want to see her too far back. Obviously, we know that you tend to want to be closer to the pace than off the pace at Kempton in these kind of races. She's a really, really nice type. She has got to bounce back, I think it's fair to say. This isn't necessarily last chance saloon, but I was a shade disappointed with what she did in the winter so far. But on ratings, she should be there or thereabouts. I think the cheek piece is going on is quite intriguing as well.
Yeah, yeah. So you and I are sort of reaching for either back form or some form, whereas you're going for the one who's fit and firing, Kate.
Yes, I am. So I'm taking the very different approach here and a shorter horse in the market. Now, this is Choicier. We're going to go with this pronunciation because we've had a lot of debate over exactly how to pronounce it. Commentators, even during the race, have pronounced their name in different ways. But yeah, Choicier, though, for me here, because as you say, she hasn't been seen for 138 days, but she is one of the joint top rated in here. But of course, she is still getting that £3 from the penalised many tiers. So it's interesting with the way that the market's gone, favouring many tiers in here. But of course, the informed Crisford Yard, though, as well. And their last two horses won also. And of course, they're set for a huge season this year. Now, we're not entirely sure of her record first time up because we've only really seen her fresh on her debut. and then her second start, which was after 2 months off as well. But that was still a really solid run for her. So hopefully she will be able to defy that, returned to this course and distance after that success last time out. So disagreement then from all three of us in our first race.
I think it's fair to say, Kate and Sam, that even though we're featuring this race, it doesn't appear in any of our best bets. This is one to go tentative with, I think.
That's very true.
Yeah.
Not to give it away, I have.
Have you?
I have.
I'm sorry.
Unfortunately, I actually have done in this one with my...
I didn't get that email, did I not?
No, it's
I was
grand.
Too busy writing ridiculous demands. Sorry
but
about
stay
that.
Stay tuned to catch the best bets. So not that we've teed it up in any sort of way there whatsoever for you.
I'll get sacked next week after this.
But of course, that is a look ahead then to our first race. Let us know who you fancy, though, in the comments section below. Now, just before we move on to our next race, a reminder, as ever, to like and subscribe to the At The Races YouTube channel and also hit the bell notification so you never miss an episode. Right, lads, on to the next one, because, again, we're at Kempton here. This is with the 240 this time. This is a Roseberry Handicap, so a 0-105 contest over a mile three. Competitive betting heat, as the betting would suggest there. Old Harrovian in Tinzo, both heading the market. So, Sam, obviously you were in flying form last week, so we're hoping to continue it in a race of this nature.
Yeah, I think I need a bit of luck, but it's the joker in the pack for me here in Cannon Rock. Jamie, you had a bit of a reaction when we were speaking about this horse earlier, because I don't like to be kind of lazy with my analysis, especially next to you, but there could be anything labelled.
Yeah,
do you think it's fair to put that on him?
Yeah, yeah. It gets overused at times, isn't it? But when you've got a horse with that profile, with that background and that pedigree as well, it genuinely is. And James Owen's done so well to get him back off that long absence. You don't see many handicapped debutants in a Roseberry, but that's what makes him so interesting.
Yeah, bought to go jumping, I believe. And obviously, he must have shown something to change their mind. And at Southall, he was 18-1 into 10-1. And the ride that his rider gave him, who takes the ride again today, was an excellently calm ride. Just delivered him into position, just sat mid-div. And the way he finished his race, the sectional time he's made, very interesting reading. I'm very hopeful there's more to come. I might be wrong. I've been wrong before. But at a double-figure price, I'm willing to throw a dart at something that could just be a bit different.
Like it.
And it's one of those races, though, isn't it, where I feel that if we did have a springer in this one, something that was at a bigger price, you wouldn't be any sort of surprise in a race of this nature, which has got a bit of a history of turning off. A bit of a surprise, Jamie.
Yeah, but equally, you can make a trend sweet spot of this race. And it's a bit like the Lincoln in terms of the lightly raced four-year-olds, 8 of the last 10 that they've won. And that fits my pick in here, who is obvious, but equally... I think really intriguing, and that is in Tinzo. We can have a look at in Tinzo at Wolverhampton, because this is one of those where, I'll level with you, I'm usually against these type of horse who come back, win a week race on the all-weather, go up £8, and you think, well, but I've been seduced by the stats here. It's the stride pattern and the sectional times of Intinzio that make him so interesting. Now, the average stride length of a racehorse is around 24 feet. This fella, it's nearly 27 feet that he was recorded at with the TPD data. And that's a huge long stride that tells us two things. Number one, he's only going to get better. And number two is that he's a much better fit for Kempton than Wolverhampton. The other point with him is that this penultimate section, he did it in 11.3 seconds. That is ridiculously fast for a mile and a half race at Wolverhampton. He's not slow, he's still getting better, and he's geared down at the finish as well. So even though he's up £8, the stats and data around him says that he's on the fast track to bigger and better things. And he's a half brother to Amtiaz, who won at Royal Ascot as a four-year-old as well. So he's an unusual horse in many respects. And even though he's joined favourite care, I think that he'll probably go off clear favourite. He's a really, really intriguing horse, that.
Sam, you can tell we've bought in the big guns, can't you? Stride pattern analysis on this, and also with the arrows and everything. We don't have a touch of the sky pad, so I'm pleased that we've got Jamie here.
He's earning his bitcoins, that's all I can say.
All 15 of them in this one.
In fairness, Kate, you do get the memo that says, don't under any circumstances touch my touchscreen at all. Let's have a look at Valsad, though, because this is your fancy.
Yes.
And just a really likeable horse who's banging form. And I think what tells us that he's getting better is that he beat three horses here who had beaten him the time before. So tell us why you like him.
Yeah, because I'm pleased that you picked out this stage of the race as well, because you look at the closing three furlong sectionals. Now, that was 34.65 at 113% as well then. And obviously reversing the previous course and distance form with the third and the fifth. But as you just said, though, there, Jamie, this was a bit of a muddling race, admittedly. The pace wasn't strong earlier on. Safi had him in a great position, was able to kick when she wanted to. I'm not entirely sure he's going to get his own way out in front in here. There's a lot of pace on in this race. So that's going to be his biggest concern. But for a horse at an each-way price, who's more than likely than not to give his running. I thought the £5 rise for that easy sound success was very fair for Valsad. So I was more going for an each way price in this because I thought it was just a muddle of a contest. But yeah, again, we're all disagreeing though. But just to reiterate, I'm with Valsad, Sam.
Cannon Rock for me.
And Jamie.
And in Tinzo, seduced by the stats.
Seduced by the stats, there you go. What better way to be seduced by than statistically led? But again, three different selections in our second race at Kempton as we move on to the 3:15 now. Now, this is the Queen's Prize handicap. This is a 0-100. For four-year-olds and over 2 miles. Now, Sweet Fantasy at 16-5. That price should be sponsoring the show by now, actually, shouldn't it? Jamie and Dex, favourite price there, heading at the market. So, Jamie, are we with or against a 16-5 shot?
No, against Sweet Fantasy and indeed Novel Legend, with the thinking that they've got other targets ahead. And I was looking more for the horses who are coming here fit and firing, and this is one where you and I, Sam, are on the same hymn sheet because we like Duty of Care here, the pair of us. Let's have a look at Duty of Care and why we've been lulled into him. And it does come from last week when he went to Newcastle. And Duty of Care is there in the green with the orange. The winner, spoiler alert, is Pridwen, who was out in front and centre. And front was the best place to be. And this is just the latest in a series, Sam, of unlucky defeats for Duty of Care, which make us feel that I think there's more to come from him at some stage, and today might be that stage.
Going back to Kempton as well, Jamie, Mr. Kempton in this race, I suppose it's fair to say, definitely suits the horse better. I suppose the only thing is, on this day, the draw was not ideal, and we've got the same problem again, haven't we? But do you think the nature of this race will set up for him to be perhaps better positioned in the closing third?
I think two things is that, number one, that they probably won't be so reactive as this, and number two is that it can only be a better pace than last week when Pridwen was benefiting from that run. So you and I are both thinking the Duty of Care. We're just yet to see the full power version of him and just think that tomorrow Kempton might be things going his way with the return to Kempton in his favour. Now, he was my first pick, but my second pick would have been Aquam, Kate. And the point to make about him is on the same day as we saw last week Duty of Care, this was down at Lingfield. Now, watch how far wide Aquam comes into the straight, because this is one of those where drawing the lanes, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, lane 6 for Aquam, and it was a, let's just keep him wide, get the momentum up, and this is really impressive in the end.
It really was, wasn't it? Like I say, the way that he has picked up here. Now, it very much was a Lingfield type of a contest, though, on the third wave with the slingshot manoeuvre down the outside. But even so, as you've just said, how comfortable this was going away at the line. Now, both of our horses have got the quick turnaround of 8 days. That's going to be the biggest question for both of them, I think, to have to answer here. For a stayer to be able to show the same form again is a whole ask in itself. Now, I know that Ian Williams, though, he's not a trainer who would do something like that lightly. So I'm going to hope that that's for positive then for him. And also, I'm hoping he's going to translate the form to Kempton, because we just said about the Lingfield form and the ride that he got there. Kempton, a very different track, but luckily for Aquam, all tracks that he's faced so far have very much come alike to him, all surfaces, all configurations. So I'm hoping that with Aquam, he should be able to take the ride back up to Class 2 company as well, which, again, shouldn't inconvenience him. So I'm pleased that you had a nod in of support then for Aquam. Maybe as a second selection, can I push you to that?
Yeah, definitely. Exactly. I think a £4 rise for that is pretty lenient given how he did it and not just who he beat.
Exactly. And not just who he beat as well. But main, just all in, Sam, on the one?
I think I'm going to go win only as well here. Because I just think it's going to be a bit of a win or a bust. I know it's a double figure price, which seduces us towards that view of each way betting. But I just think it's going to be a case of we'll be there or we won't be.
Yeah, right then. OK, this is a lot of fun, guys. Up at the Sky Pad here, we've flown through this section of the show, looking ahead to our Kempton contest on Saturday. But now it's time to head over to the soft set to look ahead to some of the races over the Grand National fences, as well as giving you our best bets for the weekend. Now, with one of the biggest festivals of the entire year up next week at Aintree, we thought it was high time to take aim at the races over the Grand National fences themselves. So, Sam, we're boosting these selections as well. So where are you kicking us off with?
Yeah, well, I drew the shorter straw and got the Fox Hunters. But that's OK. Jamie's the guest, ladies first, and then me. But the good news is I studied it for all of half an hour and ended up coming down on the favourite. So we're going to boost the favourite, but there's good reason to. Famous Claremont is a really intriguing runner. Arrives here, obviously, after winning last year's renewal of the race. But just watch that win back when you get the chance, because it was very, very impressive. I think the distance was 4.5 lengths. It could have been further. This horse this season was chinned when odds on at Wincanton in a Hunter Chase, and I think Will Biddick would definitely want to have that one back again if he could. The key to him is 2.5 miles. This year they didn't go to the Cheltenham Festival version of the race, which is over 3 miles too, because they just don't feel that he's particularly strong at that. That 2.5 miles, the Aintree fences, his jumping is pretty good on the whole, touch wood. I really like his chances. I know he was the favourite. We pushed him from 7-2 to 9-2. So if you want to get involved, I think he's a very fair price.
There you go. And there is the boost on screen as well. As you say, 7-2 to 9-2. And yeah, for all that he jumped a little bit sticky last time out, for national fences to see him in a whole different light, don't they? And like you say, he's not the most straightforward horse. And I think that's why he was ridden in the way he was last time out. But this is going to present a whole different opportunity for Famous Claremont in the Fox Hunters Open Hunters Chase. So Sam, getting us off to a solid start then for this one. Jamie, which race did you take?
The Topham. I like the Topham. Mm. It's got all of the dynamism of a Grand National, but none of the doom and dreads which you fit the claws with. But with the Topham, and you look for the key races, and the key race seems to be the play to Cheltenham, because that's got Shake 'Em Up Harry and Crabilly. But actually, this horse in fourth, Life in the Park, was beaten just 2¾ lengths, getting his mojo back with a first-time tongue tie. And actually, he was getting his second win by the finish. And the greater expanse of the Topham will serve him very well. And classically, from that Henry de Bromhead Academy, he jumps like a buck. So, interestingly, his half-brother was called Lifetime Ambition, and I backed him in last year's Grand National at a big price. And the first day, fences thought, I've cracked it, because he jumped like Pegasus, and then he got wiped out by a loose horse at First Valentine's. But there's a familial score to settle, and I think that Life in the Park is a good bet.
Sticking down the fact that's it. To rewrite the wrong, then, of the relation. 16-1 to 22-1. That's a fair boost in itself, Jamie. Are you pleased with that?
Very pleased with that, yeah.
Conventional price as well, compared to some of the other ones that was throwing at you, Jamie.
Yeah, that was the main resolution, that it was a conventional price.
More to the point. Exactly. This is win only, of course, though. So not the each way offer then, but 22-1 for the win for Life in the Park in the Topham. Now, the lads were very courteous to me because they left me with the biggest race of them all, the Grand National. I say kind, of course, probably the most competitive race of them all over the entire year. We just talked about the luck that you need in running for this. But a horse that needs one more to come out, he's 35 on the list, is Panda Boy. Now, I talked about this horse, didn't I, from our antipost section ahead of the Ultima Handicap Chasing for the Cheltenham Festival. He didn't take up that engagement, but I caveated it at the time, saying that, well, we know his main aim's the Grand National, so I'm not actually that surprised that he's not taking up the run. Unfortunately, because of that, though, we haven't seen him since the 3rd of February, when I like a horse that's run about a month ago for the National nowadays. But as I say, this has been his aim all season then. Second at Leopardstown in the Paddy Power Listed Handicap Chase, behind Meeting of the Waters, and then running a blinder over hurdles last time out. So hopefully he'll get the run. I'll be pretty confident he will get the run in this. 12-1 to 15-1 Panda Boy then, to win the Grand National win. This has been his aim. So he is hoping then that he can do the business and then another Irish success in the race again. But that is a look ahead then to the races over the Grand National fences at Aintree next week. Let us know your own fancies for any of the races in the comments section below. But now we must look ahead to the more immediate future and our best bets for the weekend. So Jamie, of course, guest of honour, only feels right, you should kick us off.
Yes, we're going to start with Intinzo, that's what you call it. This name doesn't roll off the tongue, but it will do after tomorrow, I promise you, because seduced by the stats is the phrase that we've used with regularity. That 27-foot stride, that 11.3 sectional in the penultimate one at Wolves, all of that maps out really well for him in the Roseberry. The next best comes at Chelmsford. Now, I think that Roger Varian could win any 0-85 Fillies handicap he wanted with strong impact. He's kept it for a fairly valuable race at Chelmsford, and he's starting her season fairly early with the idea that she's going to climb high. I'm just excited about what she might do this year, given the strength of some of her form. And I just like the MO of horses like Desert Cop. Don't forget that at the start of last season, he won the three-year-old final at Newcastle. He was second to Shaquille. He was in the wilderness in the second half of last year, but he's dropped in the weights. He's back in a handicap. Handicap. He's back under a sheen and he's the sort of horse who might be re-energised after that winter off.
I didn't expect anyone else to be targeting the 4.55 at Kempton, but you have done with your long shot, not again to give anything away for my own best bets. But before we do that, though, Sam, your own best bets.
Yeah, a big weekend, and hopefully we've got a couple of skinny ones in here, I think, to get us off to a solid enough start. The Knapp will probably be around even money with notable speech. This horse, 2 from 2 on the all-weather at Kempton, and has to give away a penalty to the field here, but I don't think it's the strongest in terms of opposition around the horse. Beat Cuban Tiger, who obviously went in on Good Friday and actually runs again, turned out very quickly at Chelmsford, and will run just ahead of this race, so you may well get another form boost before that. We'll move on to my next best, which is Capulet, a really intriguing runner in the 3:30 at Chelmsford. Obviously, this is a road to the Kentucky Derby via Essex, which seems a little bit of a strange way to go, doesn't it? But Aidan O'Brien sends the horse here, and this horse has got some lovely form in the book when you go back through. Should have probably beaten Diego Valesquez, I was going to say, last season. The third at Newmarket last time out when we last saw him against Ghost Rider, who won that race, looks pretty solid as well. So Capulet.
Ryan's coming, isn't he?
Sorry?
Ryan's coming over tonight.
Yeah, Ryan's over. So there's a
I hope Ryan attacks on him with more verve than you did with Diego Velasquez. sort of tuned out of that halfway through, didn't you?
So do I, yeah. And then we'll move on to Duty of Care's Longshot. Let's quickly skip past my poor ability to pronunciate words, who we've already spoken about. It is a win or bust bet for me, but I really hope Safi gets a tune out of him, even with that difficult draw.
Yes, but Capulet, like you say, is one of the most fascinating horses of the entire weekend. I'm fascinated to see how your trader is going to price him up as well, whether or not this is the aim first time up. But you say the jockey booking would suggest it is, but then he's got bigger targets down the way. So I genuinely do not know what price to put Capulet in at. So that's going to be fascinating to see for your next best bet, what price he goes off at in the end. Now, my own best bets, we kind of gave it away earlier on then, because my Knapp is going to be the aforementioned Choicier. Now, this is in the Snowdrop Fillies Stakes over a mile. Joint top rated horse in this listed contest, getting the £3 from the current favourite, Many Tears, who was actually officially rated £5 lower than her as well. Successful over this course and distance last time out. Does have to prove herself first time up this season, but the yard are in good form as well, and this looks an optimal starting point for a potential black type mare. Now, Azure Angel in the 4.55. As I say, I thought I was going to be the only one to be taking aim at this 0-95 handicap, but Azure Angel unlikely to be missed in the market, though, unlike Jamie's selection, admittedly. But hopefully this filly can continue her unbeaten all-weather record. She's 4 from 4 in this sphere, and that success last time out was very likeable. So hopefully she'll be able to defy the £4 rise and also defy her draw as well, which I think is the biggest concern for her. And then my long shot, the aforementioned Valsad in the Roseberry Handicap at 2:40 at Kempton. Such an open contest. Hopefully he takes up this engagement, not at Bath on the 7th, where he is doubly entered there, but I think this trip suits him a lot better than the potential 10 furlongs that he'll be getting at Bath. So, yeah, I think there's still more mileage in this mark. 16-1 is a fair price for me also. So, again, they are our best bets for this weekend. So, a big thank you to the lads for all their hard work. Jamie, thank you so much for stepping in for deck and for giving us a proper demo the Skypad as well.
Anytime. Thank you, guys.
No, that's it. And thank you so much to you, of course, at home for watching. Best of luck with your bets this weekend. We'll be back at the same time next Friday to preview the Grand National at Aintree.